Welcome to the 11th video in this series covering the fundamentals of screenwriting and storytelling. If you'd like to watch the rest of the videos, you can find them linked in the description below or on the end screen of this video. While screenplays are definitely written stories, they're still a blueprint for the film to come. Because of this, screenplays follow a specific format. Some writers follow this format completely, while other writers find ways to break convention and format their screenplays in unique ways. In this video, I want to go over the principles of script format and talk about when formatting matters, when it doesn't, and how to use it correctly. Let's begin. Let's start by taking a look at the rules of script format. First off, do not try to write a script in anything other than script writing software. If you like writing something that's prose and then transferring it into script format, then do so. But don't try to figure out margin, spacing, centering, and all of that in a Word document. You want to get to the point where you're not thinking about script format and instead just writing your story. You will get used to the format much quicker if you use script software. My preferred script software is Final Draft. I've also heard that Studio Binder script software is a good option if you're trying to find something free, although I personally have never used it. But if you're serious about pursuing screenwriting professionally, it would be good to take a look at a paid software like Final Draft. Scripts are written in Courier font. There are a few variations such as Courier Prime, Courier New, and Courier Final Draft, all of which are acceptable. Scripts are written specifically in this font because Courier is a fixed pitch font, which means that each character and space are exactly the same width. This allows for more standardization to the length of each page. Each page in a script is on average a minute of screen time. So if you have a 120-page screenplay, you should end up with a movie that's around 120 minutes or 2 hours long. This doesn't always hold true, but that's one of the reasons that this font is the standard. Scenes will start with a scene heading, also called a slug line. All of the letters are capitalized, and sometimes writers like to bold their slug lines to make them easier to see on the page. Scene headings give us a quick understanding of the setting of a scene. The scene heading is broken up into three sections. The first section tells us whether the scene takes place in an interior or an exterior. INT for interior, EXT for exterior. Sometimes you will have a scene that takes place both inside and outside, which will look like this. The second section is the place. In this scene from Gone Girl, the place is Nick's college office. And the third section tells us the time, usually simply day or night. Here it is day. The scene heading exists to help those actually making the film understand where to film and what time of day. It helps producers know what sort of location is needed for the scene, and it will tell the crew the time of day, which will help them light the scene correctly. Don't put noon, 2 a.m., dawn, dusk, etc. as your time of day unless it's story necessary. These times can be more difficult to get, especially dawn and dusk, so unless it's necessary to the story, write day or night. Same with using noon or 2 a.m. Unless it's story necessary, don't add it into the script. And even if it is necessary to the story, the crew will likely end up shooting noon at some point in the day and 2 a.m. at some point in the night. Next, we have action lines. Action lines are written in paragraph form using traditional sentences. Action lines mainly include two things, action and description. If a character runs into a room, you write that in the action line. If it's important that the room is covered in blood, then that description also gets written into the action line. If we go back to this scene from Gone Girl, we can see the action and description written into the action lines. In the beginning, we see, "It's dust, moody, messy, cramped," which gives us quick, short description of the room we're in. Further down we see, "He picks up a pair of scissors that sit next to a matching stapler and opens it. Boney reads over his shoulder." This is the character's actions. And this format repeats for the rest of the scene. Action lines are the element of script format that is most like traditional prose writing. A lot of your personal writing style may shine through here. But remember, screenwriting is a written story intended for a visual purpose. When writing action lines, focus on what the audience will be seeing and hearing on screen. Adding characters' thoughts to action lines can be helpful to the reader, but any thoughts will not translate to the screen. So make sure your story isn't taking place only inside the minds of your characters, because the audience viewing the film will not be in their heads. It's also a good idea to keep your action lines to 4 lines or less. This helps the page look cleaner and it's easier to read. Now we can talk about writing character names. When you first introduce a character, it will usually happen in the action lines. You will capitalize their name the first time we meet the character, and usually add a bit of necessary description. Here we meet Nick Dunn, all caps followed by a brief description, 30s, handsome. After the character's first appearance, you can write their name normally like this. Character names are most found above dialogue, like it is here. The character's name should appear in all caps. You may also see parentheticals by a character's name, such as VO, which stands for voiceover, or OS, which stands for off-screen. This helps the reader and those making the film understand how that dialogue is incorporated into the particular scene. Writing character names like this helps the reader keep track of the different characters in the story, as well as helping directors, actors, and the rest of the filmmakers understand who is speaking and how it should be filmed. Dialogue is the words of a particular character. Here, Amy and Nick have a conversation. Writing dialogue in this way makes it easy to understand who is talking in a given scene. So these are the most important parts of script format. However, there are a few more elements that can be good to know. Sometimes parentheticals can be used to explain the way a character delivers a line or sometimes performs an action while speaking. Parentheticals should be used sparingly and are usually unnecessary. However, writers do use them occasionally to describe a particular dialogue delivery or action that may seem counterintuitive to the reader. In this scene from Gone Girl, Gillian Flynn uses a parenthetical to show that Detective Boney delivers her line while not looking up. Be careful of doing this in your own writing. Actors and directors usually are not fond of screenwriters trying to direct the movie from the page. But when used sparingly, parentheticals can help a writer describe a specific action or specific line delivery. On the right side of the page in all caps, you can sometimes find transitions, such as cut to or fade out. These can help the reader get an understanding of how we are transitioning from scene to scene. While it is generally something to only do sparingly, there is a way to write in a specific camera shot if it's important that the scene be shot exactly in a certain way. Writer-director Quentin Tarantino puts many camera directions in his scripts, but since he is directing the finished product, it makes a lot more sense for him to do so. Camera shots are placed into scripts in different ways. There's a few examples on this page. In Inglourious Basterds, we have an example that says camera in all caps and then description of the shot. We also have dolly shot in all caps describing a particular type of camera shot. On the next page, we have CU Shoshana in all caps. CU stands for close up. So as you can see, there are multiple different ways to add camera shots to a script if it is necessary to do so. That's really all there is to it. Other minor tips and tricks will come from reading screenplays and getting used to how they look. Read great screenplays and read terrible screenplays. Both will teach you a lot about formatting. Now that you have an understanding of how a script is formatted, let's talk about when script format matters, when it doesn't, and how it should be used. Script format helps the makers of the film figure out how to turn this piece of writing into an audio-visual story. So the format is necessary and has a purpose. However, the format can be bent depending on your particular story. Let's take a look at some examples of breaking script format. Remember when I talked about how some writers write camera direction into their scripts? This is generally frowned upon, but this doesn't mean you cannot sometimes do it. In the opening scene of the script Chronicles, which became the film Zodiac, the writer James Vanderbilt writes, "Our camera is mounted to a car window, driving through a small town at night, passing white picket fences." If you listen to a lot of script coaches and professors, they will tell you never to write like this. However, this script was bought and produced, and this camera direction from the script is in the final film. Here's the opening shot of Zodiac, directed by David Fincher. The Social Network screenplay is 163 pages long, much longer than a more traditional script. However, the final film ended up only being 2 hours long. Sorkin knew that his script was fast-paced and dialogue-heavy. Since pages full of dialogue move much faster than pages full of action, Sorkin knew that the final film would be much nearer to a traditional film length. Moonrise Kingdom, written by Wes Anderson and Roman Coppola, has longer than average action lines with a lot of description. Most of the time, this is frowned upon because it can bog down the pace of the script. Wes Anderson is able to do this because he's going to be directing the movie, which means he has a lot more liberty with how he writes action and description on the page. While I love the film, the Moonrise Kingdom screenplay is hard to read because of the long stretches of action and description. It's a script that's meant to be shot by the person who wrote it. There are also examples of screenplays that break screenplay format in more dramatic ways. One of the early versions of A Quiet Place, written by Scott Beck and Brian Woods, was only 67 pages long. Not only that, but the script also used different fonts, pages with only one word or even a single number, using shapes beside action lines, handwriting, and even images such as a Monopoly board, button pins, and an image that compares the size of a wind turbine to the Statue of Liberty and a 20-story skyscraper. I've never seen a script break so many formatting conventions as this one. But here's the catch. This script was nothing like the film that ended up being produced, but this script did a great job of setting a tone and feel for the story. The script went through many more revisions, but the essence of the tone and feel was present in that early draft. A Quiet Place is a fascinating case study in looking at a script that breaks formatting conventions to achieve a certain tone, and this can be a good thing to do.
By freeing yourself of the rigid formatting rules here and there, you're also allowing your mind to kind of be a little freer about what could possibly happen in this movie.
Script format has nothing to do with how good or bad your story is. However, John August, the other co-host of Script Notes, said something that is absolutely correct.
Yeah, and all the rule breaking in the world will not, if you're writing, it's not fantastic.
Some writers like to break script convention just because they want to break a rule. That's not a good reason. You can definitely bend script format to your story, but you should only do it if the story calls for it, and most stories won't. Some writers take the opposite path and live and die by script format. They give notes on script formatting without ever getting into the nitty-gritty of why a story does or does not work.
An important thing to understand about rule breaking is you can't break rules if you don't understand rules to begin with.
Ultimately, script format is nothing but another way to write a story. If you're trying to rigidly follow script format or you're thinking of breaking convention, Craig Mazin offers up a question you should ask yourself.
Will this help the people making the movie deliver what you want them to deliver?
Mazin is absolutely correct. When thinking about formatting, that is your main focus. Will this help the people making the movie deliver what you want them to deliver? Write a lot. Get used to script format, and remember to always focus on writing a great story before worrying about formatting rules. So now you have an understanding of how to write a script in the correct format. Now we're going to take everything you've learned, character, structure, conflict, script format, everything, and show you how to write your first short film and actually create a strong, dramatic narrative. So if you want to watch the rest of the videos in this series, you can click the playlist on the screen now, or you can click the link in the description. And if you like this video, please leave a like and subscribe for more videos just like this one.